Luis brought these.
They're his.
Luis came with images.
There is his slideshow.
Who wants to click? Let me see if it's working.
He's going to click.
Okay. Okay, everybody got water?
Okay, give me a click.
You want to?
Yeah.
That means I could just watch. Thank you, everyone, for coming in. I think we're ready to begin the evening's event. It's a great honor and pleasure to welcome Peter Eisenman back to the AA, who will be in conversation this evening with Luis Fernandez-Galiano, who's come over from Madrid this morning for the purposes of a conversation that loosely is focused on what you could say is the state of architecture today. This conversation is an opportunity to follow up on a wonderful lecture that Peter gave last academic year, on his thoughts about architecture. It coincides also, I'm pleased to say, with an anniversary of sorts that I think was one of the things that came up in our conversation last year. In fact, it's the 50th anniversary since October 1960, and a first visit by Peter Eisenman in this building and likely in this very same room, talking about the state of architecture. It coincides with a very nice exhibition upstairs, which pairs together two buildings from Peter's career from 50 years ago, in fact, his first ever buildings in 1960, made as an architect. His competition entries for the Liverpool Cathedral and soon after Boston City Hall, both of which demonstrate more than anything the deep Englishness of his understanding of architectural culture at that time, and in fact confirms the point that Peter made in different ways last year about the role that English architectural culture has played in his own career and experience and understanding of architecture. It's a small show upstairs that Theo Spiropoulos worked very hard on this summer to put together, and we've commissioned and built physical models of two schemes that have rarely been seen in an architectural career that's often been on exhibition and display. And it's a real delight to see those alongside two incredibly interesting projects that are part of the City of Culture of Galicia campus or city that's been worked on now for a decade, really, within the office of Eisenman Architects in New York, and that I think make a wonderful conversation point of their own about two different moments in a long and very distinguished career that still continues and goes forward in strong form today.
Can I make two PSs to what you've just said? First of all, I want to say that I'm really pleased that Alan Colquhoun is here, who was one of my soulmates in those early days. He may not remember, but we jostled about a lot of things, but I think he's the only one in the room that will remember the 60s, both here and in Cambridge. And lots of water under the dam, but thank you, Alan. Always one of my heroes, and that's heartfelt, even though we jostled over several of the same issues at times, but that's another story. And the... What? You have a selective memory, Alan, but we could talk about that. I could name a street and we could talk about it. The second, I just wanted to make sure that we understood who Luis Fernandez-Galiano, to me, is one of the premier editor critics in the architectural world today. Edits two wonderful magazines, Arquitectura Viva and AV, and is always he and I spend a lot of time talking about the world. So I mean,
and soccer,
yes. Unfortunately, we do talk about soccer. And since Brett Steele runs the best school in the world, and he runs the best magazine, other than my wife's magazine. sorry, I saved myself. I'm in great company.
Thank you.
Alan, you,
My wife and Luis.
Thank you. And Luis, as I said, is just over from Madrid. He's been professor of architecture at University of Madrid. He's been a professor at universities throughout Europe, and in fact is an author of a book that I think many of you might know called Fire and Memory many years ago. And the editor, as Peter said, of magazines.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah,
yes.
She's the editor.
The editing conversation is going forward from this afternoon. Thank you. Now, we have, with that as an introduction, and again, with the larger theme being the state of architecture or the state of the art today, Luis has arrived with images. And we've done, for the last hour or two, we've been hacking around the order and number and structure of these images. But we've put together some images that Luis is going to introduce. They're his images, and they set up the basis for a conversation between these two. My job is to be a moderator in an evening that I think isn't meant to be moderate in its overall result. So, but I'm going to try and let it start with Luis. If you want to start showing some of these images, some of them might provoke Peter to comment. Some of them might provoke a next image. But I think we can let the conversation.
Well, it's not going to be provocative. It's going to be moderate, as you say. Of course, I'm so happy to be here, surrounded by friends. And of course, yes, what we have done in the last hour is to edit, following your example, my 120 images to 40, so it's going to be short, just to break the ice, because in the end we architects think with our eyes, and words are important, but images are too, and sometimes we need them to provoke conversation and to start it. And of course, the first one is London 1940, under the German bombs, Holland House destroyed, because we are living times of distress. Certainly here, also in my own country, for architects and for architecture, for many reasons. And I think that the way that the optimism that these images, of course, propaganda images, the propaganda shots show, I think is very revealing for our own situation now, how bombs may drop on us, but life goes on. Life goes on, and 10 years later, passing from words to images, André Malraux, who had fought in the Second World War, so who had experienced real distress in his life, but who also is, as you know, was a great writer, art historian, and also Minister of Culture of General de Gaulle, is spreading in his study the images he had selected for one of his books, because he understood photography as a way of recovering the remains of the great. The shipwreck that history had been in the 20th century.
I just want to a footnote again. I don't believe any Englishman would ever think that there was any Frenchman that fought in the Great War.
Well, I must say that Marot not only fought in the Spanish Civil War as in a fighter pilot, but also in the resistance in France. So believe me, Peter. Malraux was, of course.
I know he did. I was making.
No. You are making a joke, of course. Yes,
the relationship between England and France at a certain moment in time.
Yes, and at some point, of course, Malraux made his image larger than it was. But in spite of all that, we homage him. And I wanted to bring these two images of resistance, optimism in the face of distress, as an introduction of this conversation, which should be. Perhaps illustrated with images, because in the end we think with them. This is Rauschenberg in the archives of the Miami Herald in 1979, searching for images for his paintings, as I have done today, to bring to you some of some images to illustrate this conversation. And I bring them with the same sort of embarrassment that the visitors of the show of Marina Abramović and Ulay would enter the gallery between the naked body of the artists. Because in the end, any kind of conversation such as this is in the end a body sport. I want to start by putting on the table my conclusion, which is chaos is and has been glamorous, but I'm all against it. So this is the running thread of this very short presentation. Of course, chaos was so glamorous at one time that Donna Karan could produce a perfume with that name, because chaos sold. That very year, you know, the Venice Biennale was called under the motto, the architect as a seismographer. So the architect as a trembling needle that simply shaked with the shakes of the world. And if we lived in a turbulent world, it should produce turbaned architecture. Somehow Isozaki in the Japanese pavilion put images of the Kobe earthquake, which has destroyed a city in Japan, to explain that earthquakes sometimes are not metaphorical, are real. They destroy lives, they destroy cities, and then architects are not expected to represent or to evoke metaphoric catastrophes, but to heal cities and to heal lives.
Wait a minute.
But of course, I'll defer.
I'm allowed before you go too far. First of all, we have to remember that the great proponent of chaos theory just died this week, Benoit. Which was not about projecting chaos, but to use chaos as a way of rethinking how to heal, by the way.
Yes, and how to understand complexity.
And I just can't let you say this, that architecture is about healing. I've never thought that culture was necessarily ameliorative as a basis.
Good. This is one of the first disagreements that we'll later deal with. I do think that architects...
I never thought that architecture healed anything, by the way, but I won't go into that.
Well, okay. We provide services, we try to make human life better, and in that sense we heal. And in that sense that we enter into...
I don't think architecture makes any life better. I think it ever.
Well, this is not a good PR for architects, but still we'll take it.
But I mean, no, that's why I'm in this terrible position that you knew I was going to be in, that I have to say that I don't think architecture, that architecture is about culture and the evolution of culture, but it's not about making lives better.
Okay, as the editor of a magazine which is called Arquitectura Viva, which means live architecture, I cannot but be with life against culture. So culture and life will have
and
I never win with you, Peter. We always have a good conversation. But he's and you are on home ground. Don't forget it. Anyway, this created in the last decades a collection of blobs and fractures. As you know, the blobs took their name quite paradoxically from a terror movie, one of those science fictions in which Steve McQueen tried to fight this. This shapeless blob that not in the cities but undoubtedly in architectural schools reproduced like a virus. And now, Peter.
I thought it took its name from a computer terminology. Blob stands for something. It's an acronym. No, Theo, isn't it? Blob.
No, maybe.
No, but it comes out of a computer acronym, I believe.
No, yeah, but of course, the name blob is a common English word. Even I, who am not an English speaker, know it. And of course, in popular culture, it's very much associated with the Steve McQueen movie. But I'll take your word that it comes from the machines, as so many other things. And of course, catastrophes also fell upon us, and architecture sort of echoed catastrophes. Peter's as one of them, but also Danny's Leveskin with the train and of course Frank Gehry. So catastrophes and blobs more or less populated the architectural panorama. And so much so that several months ago a Basque terrorist group put a bomb in a bank headquarters, and this is how the Spanish newspapers described it. The state in which the bank headquarters has been left after the bomb. Of course, those of you that are architects recognize that this is the original state of the building, that nothing has happened here. But for the journalist, it was clear that nothing but a bomb could have created these geometries. So we come to a point in which, like Buster Keaton in 1 week, when he tries to, he buys one of these houses by mail, he mounts it, but a love rival mixes up the instructions, and when he makes it up, he finds this very nicely deconstructed house, but of course for him, it's not nicely deconstructed, but he looks at it, scratches his head, and says, something has gone wrong. And this is my point tonight, that something may have gone wrong with architecture. Of course, when the panorama in which we live is one which is marked by the economic crisis, by climate change, by the exhaustion of fossil fuels, and the wars in the world which this conspiration of circumstances have created, and we want to fight these wars with this instrument, with these tools of the consulting tool box, I think we risk losing our bearings. Of course, the image that I must say something about it. This is something that many of you may have seen it already. This is something that was prepared for the American troops in Iraq, and of course by a consulting group, because now even the matters of life and death, of war and peace, are given to consultants of amazingly. And of course, the General McChrystal, when he saw it, he said, "When we understand this slide, we'll win the war." Well, McChrystal was shortly after forced to present to leave his post, because to resign. That's the word. He was forced to resign. So now we have a new general conducting the war, following the instructions of the consultants. And of course, war has been inspirational for architects, not only because both the B-2 Spirit and of course the fighters, the F-117 Stealth, have been so inspirational for architects. You know very well that the warped shapes of the B-2, of the bomber, were designed with the same program, Katia, that Frank Gehry used for the Guggenheim. And of course, the fighter has created a whole aesthetics, which has even been branded a stealth aesthetics, that has given rise to many buildings by Brian Kohlhaas and others. But of course, this enters into a different role when we see that this reduction of architecture to brands and icons has also infected the profession itself, which has been basically given over to celebrities. Celebrity status of architects is something that I think is today corrupting the practice of architecture, and in many senses, I think producing something which we in schools are sometimes powerless to fight against, that the students want to be famous and rich and of course a celebrity before they are 30. Perhaps we should not be so critical. Of course, architects have fun become, you know, sort of advertisements, sort of walking advertisements for their own buildings for a long time. But what I wanted to stress is how architectural culture has changed from at one point, you know, this creation of heroes is not something that we have invented in the last quarter of an hour. You know, Gropius and Mies here are presented as true heroes of the culture. Gropius and Wright are presented here as heroes of architectural culture. And this is not something innocent. This creation of heroes has been done by very often falsifying history. This is the famous photo of Le Corbusier and Mies van der Rohe at the Weissenhof in Stuttgart, with Marte Stamm hat showing behind. And of course, this is the treated photograph by the Smithsons, that very appropriately to use as a cover of the heroic period of modern architecture. A heroic period needed heroes, and heroes needed to clear the ground and leave only the key men. Although, as we know only too well, the Weissenhof was a collective effort of almost 40 architects and, of course, many more. And, of course, we also falsify history, taking out, you know, the social and political context of architecture. The image which is often reproduced of the Casa del Fascio di Como by Terragni is the one on the right, the one you find in history books, but the true image is the one on the left, the one that appeared in the local newspaper the day after, and which explains the whole thing. It explains why there was a huge crowd in front, and The fact that it was not only for aesthetic reasons.
Dealing with what I consider to be architecture, and we said we were going to talk about the state of the art. You have presented what you consider to be the state of the art, and I understand your viewpoint. I don't think it's very useful for me as a teacher. What would I do, or what would a student do and say, okay, now we have to go up in the studio tomorrow and do a project? What would be, how would they begin from that introduction? What the hell would they do? And I'm at a loss to understand what it would be.
Shall I help you?
Yeah, sure, I wish okay. You would. That's what we're going to have a discussion.
No, about. Of course. What I mean to say is that, of course, we had to cut out all the examples at the end, Peter. And in the examples at the end, I was, as you remember.
Oh, hey, we can put all of those.
No, but let me say. I was showing architectures. You say you don't deal with architecture. No, I do deal with architecture. And when I say that Ai Weiwei is deeply poetic and profound architecture, believe me, I mean what I say. And when you say that pumpkins and sunflowers are the same.
Pumpkin seeds.
I know.
Not pumpkins and sunflowers.
Peter, there you are on shaky ground. No. Of course, I showed David O. Francis Carré, Lacaton and Basal, Anna Heringer, many architects that I think are dealing with the real issues of today. And I think they are doing it with a different attitude. And this is also architecture.
Now,
and I think this is.
We have to be careful about the use of terms. You assume, you use the word real issues of today, that you are in possession of what they are, and that we all should understand your terminology of real.
Okay,
I don't know why you can't just assume that because you say the real issues of today that everybody agrees with you.
Peter, I want to tell you something. In Madrid, most architects are unemployed. The offices are being destroyed. The architects are going abroad. As far as last fortnight, I was in China and I found the Spanish architects, both in Shanghai and Beijing, who do not speak Chinese, only with English, trying to get a job. Because they know they are not going to get jobs in this kind of decaying continent that Europe is now, and very particularly some countries which have been most hit by the financial crisis and the real estate.
Is the object of being an architect to get a job?
I'm sorry to say, but someone with whom you had a great friendship, Philip Johnson, said that there are only three important things in architecture.
Get the job,
okay? So that was your Philip Johnson, not my Philip Johnson. And of course, you need to make a living. And I want to emphasize that, of course, we architects have abilities that society need. We are not simply pop stars that can produce icons for a minute public. No, we have the skills. We can be the milkman of this society, because architecture is as we need it as we need the when I say milk, and I realize that the nutritious nature of milk is going to put you in again is going
no,
to force
no,
you to answer
in society. I don't have to come to the AA to be the milkman of society. I can do that in a lot of ways without coming here to, what am I studying to be the milkman of society? There are a lot of better ways to be the milkman of society than to be an architect, by the way. If that's what you're saying, architects are in fact, in your mind, the milkman of society, then I have a lot of other things that they could do. Better jobs they could get, more profoundly interested in the world's problems, bringing milk to the society, metaphorically. They could be volunteering for aid projects in Africa. They could be doing any kind of relief work but architecture. I mean, architecture is probably the least interesting to when there is a real problem. People don't need architecture. It's not something that anybody needs, by the way, other than culture needs architecture. And that's what you're not talking about, because culture isn't bringing milk to people. Culture is something other.
Because culture is bringing caviar. Is
no.
that so, Peter?
Culture
Come
is
on.
Something else that, and you and I know what we're talking about. I'm saying is that I'm talking to students, both of us are talking to students, and I'm saying is, if in fact you say that architecture should be the milkman of society, the images that you showed to me, I don't need to go to school to do. I don't need to learn anything. I can go out and do that stuff. I can build bamboo huts. I can build mud brick houses in all kinds of societies. I don't need any architectural training to do that. I can learn how to do that in the field. So why are we here? I think this is a totally redundant institution. When I can go to India, I can go to Sri Lanka, I can go any places and learn how to build buildings.
Because you have a very reductive image of architecture. I think you reduce architecture only to icons, to architecture endowed
are
with
icons,
a symbolic...
Are icons necessary for the society? They've always been necessary.
Yes, but of course you...
But that's what we're... Supposedly these people are here because every society has needed icons. Not every architect is Borromini, not every architect's Palladio, not every architect's Corbusier, but all the societies in the past, whatever horrors they've gone through, have always needed icons. And there are necessary, we need to train people to be able to make those icons. And they're not caviar, they're milk as well. And I'm saying every society needs that kind of milk. And there are people here who are going to be those people. And that's what they aspire to. Thank God they aspire to it, and thank God there's an AA. Because if there weren't, the future societies will be without icons. And of course, as you know, icons are what cause revolutions.
Okay, so I understand that this school is an icon-oriented school. Is that how you would present it? We are an icon-oriented school. Is that what you tell your students? No, it seems like a curiosity. Because I wasn't aware of that when I came. I saw you try to produce architects.
I think in a way what's alighting together is the idea of the contemporary being about the icon. I think one way to distinguish each of your positions is in listening to Peter's response to his own question, which is how do I teach architecture? The first examples he offered were historical. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a discussion to be had about the contemporary condition and whether that's what drives architects' thinking, or that the discipline or the field or its culture has a history, and where would that history lie as a productive or a pedagogical or even a personal kind of interest. I think it is fair to say, in looking at the images shown, that history is no longer present in
right.
contemporary culture. And in fact, architectural culture seems deeply obsessed with the contemporary condition in all of its forms. And I think one question then to both of you is what role might history play as we go forward, or in fact, whether that has a possibility, and history is
maybe
taken
I
over by technology
yes.
or other interests.
No, of course, I may not have pushed my case strongly, but of course I showed some images which manifested the distortion of history. Mm. I think we need the true history, the real history of architecture. Which
what
is not
true history. What these words that you use, you cannot just say we need the true. You sound like some minister in the Bible Belt. We need the true God. How do you know what the true history is? You don't. There are many histories. Don't say we need the true history, because then I'm going to get down on my hands and knees and say, so God save us from truth in that sense, because you're not in possession of it, nor am I. And that makes me angry when you say reality, that you know what reality is and I don't, and that you know what truth is and I don't. We cannot argue on that basis, because then you're like when James Sterling and James Gowan had a partnership, and Gowan used to say, you know, I really hated working with Jim Sterling, because when we would argue over something, Jim would say, I know the truth, I know the real thing, we're doing it this way. And you can't argue like that.
No, Peter, of course,
you just can't have a partner like that.
he didn't for long. But I mean, you can't say...
No, you are right. No, I take your point. You are right, and my expression was perhaps dogmatic. I take it, of course.
Perhaps.
But at the same time, I said perhaps, but why did I say perhaps? Because you know, this postmodern relativism has been a virus. And I think that some things can be ascertained. I think you have two images of the Casa del Fascio. You can say which was the one that the camera took, the one that was doctored. This I believe, Peter. And so not everything is relative. Hmm. You know, some things are historical truths.
No.
And it is true that every...
There's no facts, as Colin Rowe used to say, are like sacks. If you don't fill them up with values, they do not stand up. So there are no facts. Facts are dealt with values. You're talking with a value system, and I have a value system, and there are no facts.
No, I'm sorry. That far, I would not go with you. I would admit that every generation writes its own history of the past to justify its present.
This is true. September 11th, yes, there's a fact that Mohammed Atta was one of the group that blew up the World Trade Center. He didn't do so because he was an architect. That's a value judgment that you're reading into it. There's no way that because Mohammed Atta was studying architecture that he blew up the World Trade Center. That's a bunch of junk, I have to tell you. It's accidental that he happened to be an architect. It sounds good for a story, but it's not why he blew up the World Trade Center, because he was an architect. Sorry.
Peter.
That ain't a fact. That's a value judgment.
You are joining the dots and getting a different story from my lips.
Of course.
This is nothing which I did not say.
That's called values.
Of course. No, this is called dressing the sort of... an image for this?
I never knew till tonight, Peter, that Mohammed Atta studied architecture, was a graduate student in architecture in Hamburg. Never heard that story until tonight.
Okay, you must do some work, some homework. But in any case, Peter...
I've got to watch out for all architectural students and potentially bombers, if I extrapolate out.
But of course, no, I wanted to answer Brett's question about history. Mm. The fact that I think that both of us love history and respect it and teach it. So you are again, you know, building the sort of putting in my lips words I haven't said to destroy them. And this, I think, is not good manners, Peter. We are friends. No, we love history, and I may disagree with you when you say
against history. I didn't say
no.
That.
You enjoyed
it.
He brought it, and I never mentioned the word history. Yeah. I said there are no facts.
Okay, I take that. But history was implied when we were discussing Borromini versus Bernini.
We didn't discuss that here.
No, brought it up in suggesting what you teach your students. I mean, to come back to the point you were making in trying to answer your own question of how do I teach students.
I want to get over being bad manners, because I've been... listened to a lecture tonight. I didn't hear a discussion.
No, but Peter, let's say something. When you tell me, when you hear that and say, now what are you going to teach your students? You can't teach them a Palladio or a Borromini, because after that, what Palladio or Borromini have to do with architecture? Of course, this kind of accusation is so cheap that I cannot believe it coming from your...
Let's not get into that. You were talking about
of course
truth.
Not.
You were talking about truth and reality. I simply think
that architects every now and then need a reality check. Simply, open your eyes and look out of the window. Simply. And I think that we are living in a difficult moment for the profession and for our continent, I would even say. And let's wake up, because nobody's going to do it for us.
And then
we may say, no, but we are in academia, I only want to discuss Borromini. The rest of it is not culture.
You say, all right, now you said wake up, and they all say, we're ready, Luis, to wake up. What do they do then, when they've woken up?
Maybe they're already awake.
All right, they're awake. What do they do? What do I teach these awakened students? What do I do? Because I haven't a clue. When you say, wake up, the capitalist system is going down, right? As the British Empire went down at the end of the 19th century, at the end of the 20th century, the US Empire is going down. Hard to say in America, but I can say it here in England. So, what are architects to do about that? That is a value judgment that can be made, right? that the system is going downhill. Am I to jump ship and go to China? What am I supposed to do in that situation?
Peter, to begin with, to be aware. Secondly, you can continue teaching Palladio.
Yes, of course.
And of course. Of course.
While Rome burns.
Yes.
No, but okay. It's been said that what all great teachers do is listen to the students, to a degree, to find out what the students are saying. And I'm curious, right. In your shared experiences, what are the students saying to you as teachers in terms of their interests?
They don't want to study Palladio, that's for sure. That is for sure.
Yeah, they've been saying that for a long time to you, right? But you keep teaching it.
I keep teaching it. Fortunately, I don't have tenure, so I could be dismissed at any time. Right? But I ain't worried about that because that's all I can teach. Because I can't teach social awareness. That's not in my nature. I separate my teaching from existence. I believe teaching is supposed to be, Cynthia doesn't like this phrase, but is a speed bump to get away from reality. Education is something that says, yeah, it's not so good out there, but it's not about training me to overcome that reality and get a job. It's to learn about architecture. And it's nothing to do with getting a job, becoming proficient in computer literacy, etc. It's to learn about when I do become proficient at computer literacy, how do I do architecture, right? And how did people do architecture throughout history, right? Mm-hmm. There have been other bad times in history. So I believe that the only way to tell them about how to do architecture is to give them historical examples, right? And the history of architecture, whether Luis likes it or not, are made by iconic figures and iconic buildings, unfortunately. They're not by the everyday. We don't have to teach the everyday because it'll always be there. But the reason why we teach Borromini, Palladio, Ledoux, Boulay, etc., on down to Corbeau and Mies, etc., is because they have produced what we know to be our history. And as Alberti says, we can't do anything without the history. And those histories are written by what I would call big work, right? The history of literature is this, the history of music is this, the history of art is this. So why not architecture? Because architecture is no different in terms of the culture than these other disciplines. And therefore, while Luis may say that we agree, clearly we disagree about a lot of things, right? And I think that I cannot teach reality nor truth. I can only teach what I know to be in. As I always say to my students when they say, well, what is it? The senator in the hearings on pornography in the United States said, I don't know how to define it, but I know it when I see it. And I feel the same way. I don't know how to define it, but I know it when I see it, right? And I'm not convinced, as Luis is that those peanut shells or whatever those things were, is architecture, all right? And I got a problem. I'm an old-fashioned guy, and when I see that, I say, I can't extrapolate that into architecture. I don't know what the hell I'm supposed to do with those. They looked like actually clamshells to me when I saw them. And I say to myself, now what the hell, honestly, what is the lesson that I learned from that? About space, about space making, about any of the kinds of things that we as architects do. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what the answer is. I honestly don't. And I'm not trying to be a cheap shot artist. I'm just saying is, hey man, the image, that's a nice image. You know, I go see the show. It don't happen to be my kind of art, right? And that's another problem probably that I'm not convinced of it as art.
Let me say that, of course, for the sake of discussion...
Yeah, we're doing this.
No, you are going far away from your own substance. When I praised your memorial in Berlin, for many they would say, this is not architecture.
They do say it.
Of course.
Yeah.
This is not architecture as we know it. Right. And however, is a deeply significant work, in which the sound of your steps when you go through this labyrinth mm-hmm. is as important as the sound of your steps when you step, you know, on
the peanut shells.
No, not the peanut shells. Peter, say it well. Sunflower seeds.
Sunflower seeds.
Okay.
I have attention deficit.
You always forget. In my case, I think that there is so many connections between this work of Ai Weiwei and your work in Berlin, that if you were, because they are deeply inspiring and profound works, and you should feel, you should warm to it. And I'm surprised I cannot manage to do it, simply because for the sake of discussion, you need to be against my one but last
No,
image.
Wait a minute, first of all, no. wait a minute. First of all, we agreed that this was a performance and that we needed to have opposites. No sense agreeing with you. Right? I mean, what the hell would they be here for?
Yeah.
They're interested in the show, and I said, I'd make sure we get one, right?
Okay.
And but you have to understand, if you really were asking me, is that your kind of art? I don't think there's any relationship between those sunflower seeds and my memorial in Berlin. Honestly, I don't. But
okay, I'll try to persuade you over dinner.
Okay.
And of course, I also confess that I put it at last.
But I'll tell you what.
It made a very good transition to the milkman sort of walking on rubble, you know. So of course, there was a kind of cinematographic reason for that. With Brett, when we cut the images, we left 40 of them, and this transition with respect.
Let me ask you a question.
So it has to do with things which are dear to your heart, which is, say, syntactic integrity.
Let me put it this way. I don't think the monument in Berlin is reflective of the sense of my work, number one. Number two, it is such a unique assignment that I don't think it has any interest in general to a student who's studying architecture or wants to know what architecture is, because I would never take them to Berlin and say, there's architecture, because I don't think it's a useful lesson. It is too aberrant in terms of what are the problematics that we face. Now, I think we could talk about the difference between the individual building, let's say in the work of an architect like Jim Sterling, and the urban projects of an architect like Jim Sterling, and compare them, let's say, to the urban works of Arnaldo Rossi or Matthias Ungers. And I think we could have an interesting discussion about the pros and cons of the individual building versus the urban building as an urban strategy, as Rossi calls it, as an urban artifact. Then I'm on some kind of ground that I can deal with. But you know that when we looked at these images, and whether there were 120 of them, 40, I told you from the get-go that I have very little I can say about those images. I told you that because that is not my area of expertise. You're an editor. You deal with those kinds of phenomena. I'm an architect and a teacher. I can relate to the work of Jim Sterling, and I can point out which works I think are relevant for students to know about. The same with Matthias Ungers, the same with Rossi, the same with Kuhlhaas, the same with Zaha and Patrick. I can relate to those things and understand what they are. But I cannot relate to analogous images of destruction and these kinds of things and say that I can understand what to do about those things when presented to a student audience.
Well, I'm surprised to hear, and I think it's been taped for the record, that Peter thinks that his memorial in Berlin is not significant of his work.
It isn't.
Representative,
I said. Yeah. It is not representative of my work at all.
But of course, may I express my guess that it will be the one of your works that is going to endure?
It's because...
And that sometimes architecture is understood better when you push it to the limits? And this is why I try to explain why the Ai Weiwei installation in the Tate is architecture. Because it's architecture pushed to the limit. You of course, we are on more familiar ground when we compare Bernini with Borromini. But why don't we go further? Those works that really do move us and that change us.
In what way, I would like to know how that installation at the Tate has any analogous relationship to what these students are studying today. It's not spatial, number one.
Absolutely spatial, because it's a field that you walk on. Now they don't let you walk on it, but this is a pity, because for, well, a conspiracy of circumstances dealing with health issues. But it's a field you walk on, which is very fragile, because it's made of ceramics, of porcelain. There are 100 million small pieces which have been created by an army of workers.
How much were they paid to do it?
Well, this is part of the story of the whole thing. How used the commission.
How many people were taken advantage of and paid minimum wage to produce 100 million of these? How many is enough? Why only 100 million? Why not 200 million and more people? I mean, you cannot tell me that 100 million of these products were made by people earning a wage. Otherwise, no one could have afforded to make this piece. There had to be some.
You mean to say that they are the product of slave work? Is that what I hear?
They could have been.
But they are not.
They're not.
Well.
So that if let's say it cost a dollar to make one of these, let's say.
Come on, you are going to make.
$100 million for this work? I mean, I agree in spending money on culture, but that doesn't seem to be the kind of argument you want to make, because I made the argument that I thought it was necessary to spend $40 million on the new sets for Das Rheingold in New York, and you suggested that maybe that's not money well spent. So how do you justify?
I did not suggest that. No, I simply looked at you with fascinating.
Yeah. Well, I'm looking at you on the 100 million.
And sunflower seeds.
Sunflower seeds.
Let's see if we get
made
it.
In porcelain, by the way.
Yeah.
They must
and
be
hand painted.
And hand painted. Holy.
But it seems what the two of you are sharing in your disagreement is an attempt to is a desire to argue the point through the effects of the project, and whether that's an effect that's genuinely architectural or not. And you've taken different positions.
Yeah.
But I think one of the points that Ai Weiwei is raising clearly is he's ramped up, like many artists around the world, his architectural ambitions. And like Olafur Eliasson and many other artists today, these are artists running studios with more people in the design studio than many architects doing these kind of projects. One of the things
most
that
of them are bad architects.
Yeah, no, there's a real debate being held across Europe about the legitimacy of that as either an art project or an architectural project. I think that's a separate discussion. But what they are revealing at a certain level is the return of an interest in the 1960s in places like New York. And I'm thinking of Saul Lewitt's early writings, Robert Morris, and others. Mm-hmm. Who were interested in architecture being defined through the practice of giving instructions to people to go out and make the objects.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, that for an artist, that was quite a radical position to take in that original conceptual generation, that would just write instructions and then the art object would be made. They were trying to draw a line between the artist's identity and the final project. I'm interested that neither of you seem to have an interest in the practices themselves, but really in judging the merits of the final installation or piece, and whether it's spatial or not, whether it's architectural or not in its effect. And I think there is a larger discussion to be had about how you then draw a boundary around a discipline, let's say of architecture, that can keep outside things like a sculptor's work or a painter today or Olafur's massive studio in Berlin.
Let me say one thing that frustrates me.
Full of architect trains.
I thought I would convince him easily that Ai Weiwei work is critical.
Hmm.
In the sense he uses the word critical, which is a very reduced one, that this is a critical work, and it is more critical than the stadium, the Virginia Stadium that he did with Jack Herzog. This is my opinion. Of course, he did the Berlin Stadium, and in fact, the initial idea was his about the web that made the sort of the bird's nest and so on. But I did really feel that you would warm up to it. No, I mean it.
I don't want
as a real critical practice of someone who is an architect and an artist at the same time.
You're expanding the field of a critical project or a critical practice.
Yeah, who is an artist and an architect doing critical things that are forcing us to think about China, think about our world, think about ourselves, think about our bodies, think about materials.
May I give you a word from Richard Serra, my sometime colleague on the Berlin Project. And Richard went to see the Berlin Project after it had been done. And he called me up, typical Richard Serra, who I think is one of the great artists of our time, and very much interested in architecture and the relationship of his work to space, and architectural space. And anyway, Richard called me up, and he said, Peter, I said, Richard, he said, Berlin, great work. And I said, thanks, Richard. He said, no, not just a great work. It is your best work ever. I said, thank you. And he said, you want to know why? And I said, tell me, Richard. He said, no plumbing. And hung up the phone. And this is what a great sculptor thinks about architecture, by the way, and the analogous relationship to sculpture, in that sculptors don't deal with one client, and the reason why he quit the project was that Helmut Kohl blew him out of the room, and Richard said, I don't have to deal with this in my work, and he asked me how it's possible to be an architect having to deal with clients like Helmut Kohl. I said, that's what architects deal with, and they also deal with plumbing, and overcoming clients and plumbing and all those kinds of things, and still being able to do architecture is why it's more interesting than sculpture. And that's why I don't believe that whatever his name is, Wawa Wei or whatever. I don't know what the guy's name is. I mean, but
what is his name?
Ai Weiwei.
Ai Weiwei.
Ai Weiwei.
Ai Weiwei. Anyway.
No, but let me say something, Peter, because now you are clearly, I think, provoking me. No,
I want to.
Most of the architecture you teach,
I'm trying.
Most of the architecture you teach and you admire, hasn't got any plumbing. In fact, Le Corbusier was famous for saying, "Pour le doux, c'était facile, pas de tube."
Yeah.
This is what Le Corbusier said. He had to put some plumbing, but Le Duc had not.
Yeah.
So from Le Duc backwards, no plumbing.
No plumbing.
So this is not the real reason. No. If I may say something about your memorial.
Yeah.
I think it would be even a more moving work if the ground would be gravel instead of the solid thing that you used.
We couldn't.
It would be closer to Ai Weiwei because you have the sense. No, because you have a sense of stepping on the earth, being connected to the earth, and not with this kind of paving that you put in the blocks.
Handicap access. We had it first stand and pebbles and things like that, and all of the people in the handicapped administration said, we cannot have wheelchairs on that. No way. You have to have solid paving. So there you go.
But you agree that with pebbles would have been much better.
I don't know about that.
Well, I'm convinced.
It would
have
been different.
I'm convinced. Well,
anyway.
I remember, Pete.
Look, we're not getting. Anyway. Luis, the real issue is, or an issue, not the real issue, because I don't want to use terms like that. An issue on the table is whether metaphors from other disciplines can inform architecture. And I would say 30 years ago, I was one of the proponents of metaphors coming from other disciplines, linguistics, from painting, from any number of discourses. And I slowly began to understand in my own work that architecture is, in one sense, it is what I would call an autonomous discipline, and therefore analogies from other discourses are not very useful, because ultimately, how do you, in a sense, bring them into architecture? And if you don't know how to do architecture, understanding metaphors from sculpture or painting or linguistics or physics or any of the kinds of imagery that you were showing, I think is not very useful for becoming an architect today. my feeling.
But you know, it's often needed to promote architecture.
It's often
and to get it on the media.
Yeah, I know, but
you know, if you call the stadium in Pekin, in Beijing, sorry, the bird's nest,
yeah.
I think it people warm up to it. Alejandro described his Yokohama building as the Hokusai wave, famously, and defending the need for the architect to provide the right metaphor, so that.
Well, even the City of Culture, I think there was a very early stage of the competition where you did something like that. But very early on, before it then moves into the design phase. And
yeah, but I
with the Venera. Hmm. Yeah, with the shell.
Yeah.
So would you say that the use of Santiago's shell was a metaphor or not?
The difference is whether you're promoting something or teaching students how to be architects. I think there's an enormous difference about promoting an awareness among non-architects about how to understand architecture and teaching students to be architects. I think there's an enormous difference. And I don't think that all the exercises in public relations about how we sell and brand architecture has anything to do with teaching students or to practicing architecture. I think we have to distinguish between the two. That's all I'm saying is, and I don't want anyone, you are a very serious editor and critic. You and I agree sometimes and disagree, but I'm not thinking that the illustrations that we cut away, right, and we could have them here, would be making our differences any more clear. And fortunately, you are able to, you have a magazine, you have several magazines, you have vehicles for dispersing ideas in a different way than people who practice architecture. And I think is an enormous difference between what you do and what I do. And there always will be. And I believe that it's very difficult to teach not what you do, but what I do, how to teach students today. I find it really, really difficult how to teach architecture, because they all ask me, what is architecture? And as I said, I don't have an answer to that question. And they say, well, how can you teach it if you don't know what it is? And I think that's also a good question. But I ain't sure that anybody else has any answers either. And I'm not sure that critics or historians have any answers either. So I think we are in a difficult moment because there is no dominant stylistic thing to copy. There are no dominant modes of expression. And we are in a very difficult moment for people who are both teaching and learning to do architecture, and I think we ought to recognize that. I mean, there is no agreement as to what constitutes. I mean, Alejandro is here, Patrick is here. They are examples of other generations, at least, certainly not mine. But you could bring any number of people here. You could bring Greg Lynn here. You could bring any number, Hernan Diaz Alonso, all of whom, Patrick, Alejandro, Hernan, Greg, have all taught at Yale, where I happen to teach, and there doesn't, as does Dimitri Porfirios, as does Leon Freer, and there doesn't seem to be any generalized agreement that you could say between all those figures. Yet they all have something very valuable to tell students about architecture, but it's not necessarily either truth or reality. They all have their versions of truth and reality, and thank God for that, that there is an enormous diversity. There isn't a canon, or there isn't a way of practicing architecture. That's because there are no answers to the questions, and these people, I don't think either Alejandro, Patrick, Greg, Dimitri would say they have the answer. Leon does say he has the answer, I have to confess. He believes there is a right way. And that we are all at wayward, and he would include you as well in the wayward. Mm. I always worry when Leon gets going because I know where that ends up. It ends up in Tree of Smoke, which I don't think is a good idea. And I've been here at the AA and said it once before. I ain't going to say it again. I'll use a metaphor. I think that I think it would be really useful at this moment, Brett, to see if there are any questions or comments in the audience. I'm certain there have
been. But before you ask for questions,
let me just get the microphone while you follow
yes,
up on that.
Let me tell Peter something. All of these people in jail that he has described, of course, they are very varied, but they have one thing in common. Most of the students imitate their masters. And what you see in your studio or in the studio of Leon or in the studio of others, very often is mimesis. By that I mean learning by imitating.
I don't think Alejandro would agree with you.
I mean, in a way you could say also what those figures share is a belief that you can make a certain kind of architecture that changes other architectural minds.
Right.
And I think that's a fairly small subset in the bigger world of architecture. And I think that's one thing that I think binds that group of people together.
The reason why they're teachers, let me say this. I used to teach with Michael Graves. The two of us are great buddies. We couldn't be more different in our attitude toward architecture. I used to tell the students, if you're going to study with Michael, if you choose to study with Michael, then you better learn what Michael has to teach. You ought to at least understand his discipline and his discourse. I say the same way about Leon. I say the same about Dimitri. If you're going to choose to study with those people, then learn what they have to teach. Michael can't teach Richard Meier, and you don't study with Michael to learn about Richard Meier. You study with Michael to learn Michael. So they are master examples. And Yale has Patrick and Alejandro and Zaha to come and teach them those kinds of examples. It's not mimesis. It's to understand master exemplars of today. And I think that's a reasonable way to teach. That's, to say that Alejandro at 32 is a master exemplar, is hard to do, but, nevertheless, he is. He's one of them, and I applaud that. I think having Pierre Vittorio O'Reilly here, and they teach master, and the kids all do these ridiculous projects that he embraces, but I think it's important for them to do that. And so, whether you call it mimesis or not, I think there's no way to study with me, and if I'm being honest to my own, and if I have a discourse, I gotta teach it. That's what the reason why I'm teaching. Otherwise, what else am I supposed to do? Teach Patrick? that would be it.
I did see a couple of studios at Princeton where you did Seattle Public Library and Lagos, I recall.
Yeah, we did. Yeah. We did those as exemplars of other ways of dealing with the project, right? Purposely. Yeah. We took Seattle Public Library and Lagos. First of all, we did Lagos with somebody from Lagos, by the way, so that was useful. Anyway, let's...
Only one thing. Mimesis was not... taken
as negative.
On the contrary, I think that mimesis is very productive, and of course, in Madrid at least, we think that the students learn more from each other than from the sort of the formal nature of the university. I think that you bring intelligent, motivated people in the same place, and they create an atmosphere in which. Mutual learning is the key thing.
It's not by accident that there were great moments in the history of the AA when Peter Smithson was teaching here, when Cedric Price was teaching here, when Peter Cook was teaching here, when Elia was here, when Leon was here, when Rem was here. Come on. The history of this place is about the history of great people having taught here who may not have been great at the moment, but became great examples. So I would argue that God bless icons, God bless iconic buildings, God bless the history of icons. I'm sorry to invoke God, but it's in vogue in the United States these days. I would say I'm all for it.
Should we do the audience questions?
Yes.
And Alan, thank you as an icon in my history. Thank you very much.
Hi. This is a question for Peter. I was just wondering. I noticed that you took issue with Iwerwe's, or with the exploitation evident in Iwerwe's work. However, I read an interview with you in, and it could have been a misquote, so I don't want to put too much faith in the press. But I read an interview with you in 2004 or 2006 where you advocated not paying your interns, and I was wondering how you reconcile those two opinions.
I didn't advocate that. I said it was a fact, right? It was a fact because, number one, we are not allowed to pay foreign interns because they don't have working papers. They are tourist visas. So anybody that comes to us, they're only allowed to stay for 3 months on tourist visas. And we would be in trouble with the IRS, which we've been in the past, when we did pay our interns, right? The American interns that we have are all coming from universities where they're getting college credit for what they're doing and therefore are paying tuition to where they are, and they choose to come as interns. So I don't have any problem because, first of all, if someone comes for 3 months, let's say you were to come for 3 months, it would cost me more to break you into what was doing and become useful in the office as opposed to what? Yeah, but we don't make $100 million of anything, by the way. We don't work overtime. We don't work on Saturdays. And anybody who comes to us, I would imagine, knows ahead of time what the situation is. I don't think the situation is anyway the same.
Questions?
And by the way, all architects that I know use unpaid interns, as do sculptors, as do people in music, as do people in advertising. Unpaid interns are a way of gaining knowledge, let's say. And I don't feel it's in any way exploitive. I don't know how you make $100 million of anything without exploitation. But that was the only reason I did.
I mean, it seemed to me that the point about the only point of contact between the Ai Weiwei and the Holocaust Memorial is that you said, I mean, in different ways, that they were subject to one thing that neither of you mentioned, which is the monstrosity of health and safety regulations.
Yes.
Which is actually constitutes sort of by extension and a kind of initial form of reality. I mean, it seemed to me the logic that what differentiated the two of you is one says, wake up, look out of the window and see reality, and the other one says, wake up, look at the window. And it sort of would be expressed sort of in quite a brief way as that. And I think, the problem with the invocation of any kind of reality is, I mean, not only what kind of Peter's already kind of said, I think the only person who has something interesting that's not like a philosopher when they come to kind of specify what reality is, which is Freud. For Freud, reality is simply that which is an obstacle. And therefore, insofar as students need to be taught about reality, it's actually reality as things you bump into, as things which kind of your desires bump into and have to take account of, in a sense, become a world of constraints. Because that's what both architecture and art, but differently, relate to. I mean, it seems to me, the problem is precisely there are all sorts of artists wishing to be bad architects, and all sorts of architects wanting to be bad artists. And that's actually like a real problem. I mean, if you look
the architectural design work of Olafur Eliasson in the new kind of opera house in Oslo. You think, do for God's sake, stick with the the artwork.
You can try Frank Stello's.
And in a way, the Turbine Hall's become a sort of mockery of this sort of problem. Precisely insofar as, I mean, I agree that the Weiwei, I mean, has to be considered, how could it be considered architectural? I mean, the setting, the Turbine Hall, indeed is architectural and provides a space in which you can think of an installation. But the logic of that installation is entirely from, like, the history of installation art. It's not using space as an architect would consider it. They may use the common word space, but they mean entirely different things. And what you have, I mean, the Turbine Hall is very instructive, because often, because the scale is very large, the artist gets tempted into kind of architectural propositions, like the Anish Kapoor, which was just a small object massively scaled up. So the question of space is, it seems to be entirely different for the practice of installation and the practice of architecture.
Here's what I would say to Luis in closing this discussion. We'd like to have more questions. We took the students to see the Scrovegni Chapel in Padua. I had seen it 50 years ago, actually, when it was still under reconstruction, and today it's been restored brilliantly. And I would say to any student of architecture that to see the Giotto and to see the painting and to see the space is more important than to seeing Wai Weiwei in the Tate Gallery. And until they see that, as a primer, I would keep them away from the Tate Gallery, all right? Because I'd make sure they saw those things first, because there are some things that come before other things. And I remember when Colin Rowe was taking me around to see Italian painting, he said, look, we can't go to Florence and Bologna first, because the way to understand Florentine and Bolognese painting is to go to Rome. And you've got to see Michelangelo and Raphael, and you've got to go to the Raffaele Stanze and see Giulio Romano. And then we can go and see Bronzino, Pontormo, Parmigianino, Carracci, etc. And in that sense, he was, for me, right, okay? That in order to understand Bronzino and Pontormo, you've got to go to Rome first. Now, I would argue the same thing about architecture, that there are certain basic lessons of architecture that I think have to be learned before you can get into very sophisticated problematics. And what I believe is a problem of always been a problem of architecture, that the people teaching architecture have never seen architecture for the most part, don't know what they're teaching, and therefore how the hell are the students supposed to learn? I was fortunate in having a teacher who took me to see all of these buildings over the course of 2 years when I was in Cambridge. There have been teachers here at the AA, and there still are some that take students to see these works. I don't think you can teach architecture in any other way. I mean, in other words, I don't think you can teach design. I think you can take people and say, this is what it is, figure it out for yourself. I've never been able to teach design. But I think you can teach people how to see. And seeing as an architect, I believe, is different than seeing as a critic, as an art historian, or as a client. And what is unfortunate is, I think there's a big deal of difference seeing that installation at the Tate and seeing the Scrovegni Chapel. One is an artwork and an installation, and I don't believe hits the basic premises of what constitutes architecture. And I would stand on that, and I hold that. Until you've seen the Scrovegni Chapel, don't take me to the Tate. Take me to see the Scrovegni Chapel. And I would never take the Tate as an example, because just because it's up to date, I say the Scrovegni Chapel is more up to date
than anything that we'd ever see at the Tate.
Peter, but I must say that your either-or attitude
always
is deeply flawed, because I think we must have them both. We must take our students to see Romanesque chapels and Renaissance buildings and to Islamic architecture. No.
Even in the 120 slides.
Those are not my students.
This is an
audience.
Either.
This is an audience for which we perform for 15 minutes. Okay?
No, we're proposing questions for them. But
what I simply wanted to point is that, of course, the students must be familiar, and not only in books, but in visits.
In visits.
Of course, to historic architecture. I think in this we both agree. But I would add that Ai Weiwei installation at the Tate is the last chapter of a long process, yeah, which includes your Giotto chapel, and that there's a thread that links them both. It is very good that the students understand Ai Weiwei going back in history.
Can I tell you what? My students haven't had enough of Giotto to be able to go to the Tate. That's what I'm saying is, I need to take them to see more of those things. I'm not there yet. You're ahead of me. I'm a slow learner. Anyway, some more questions?
Some more questions?
Yeah.
Let's do one over here.
Yeah, they got a lot of questions out here too.
Hello, hi. In one of the slides, Professor Galiano talked about the present problems nowadays related to fossil fuels and global warming and, you know, all the bad stuff happening. I remember about a year ago, I was having an informal conversation with Professor Jenks, Charles Jenks, and he mentioned that more pressing than global warming is the fact that we can fall into some sort of fascism. Also, in Fire and Memory, Professor Galiano talks about the relationship between architecture before the Industrial Revolution, there was a relationship between, space and how spaces were shaped and their thermal requirements and what it was needed to heat them up or cool them down or whatever. And I'm just curious to see if an Eisenman building could be thought in also those terms, because architecture nowadays needs to be more efficient. If we want to build in the future, it needs to be more efficient and more economical in those terms. So I'm just curious.
I don't know what it means I don't know what more efficient is, because that's, again, the term more. Is it mean solar, using solar energy, which is a high initial cost and really messes up the aesthetics of a building, which I think are, you know, cost-wise very important. So I don't know how to answer a question like that. I really don't, because efficiency is a condition of capital. Efficiency is what creates what I call surplus, which is what makes the production consumption cycle go. So, but architecture isn't a surplus, it's an excess, which is different than a surplus. It's outside of production consumption, it's outside of efficiency, and more efficient, which is a goal of late capital. So therefore, I cannot say that I'm interested in making my buildings more efficient. I'm interested in the excess necessary to create architecture outside of the production consumption cycle.
If architecture is about culture and architects are editors of culture, then why study architecture? Why don't we study cultural studies?
Good question. I haven't a clue why you're studying architecture. I mean, I would, if you said to me, shouldn't we study culture? But I mean, the question is, how would you study culture? Because architecture, if we were to look, let's take Italy, for example. There are 12,000 students of architecture at the university in Venice. There are 12,000 at the university in Milano, one of the universities. They're not going to be they're not ever going to be architects, et cetera, because they don't need all those architects. They are studying architecture the way in the late 19th century people studied law as a way of understanding culture. And what many Italians believe is that architecture is a way of understanding culture. It's a way to one of the best ways to understand urbanity, history, infrastructure, any number of cultural relationships. So you could argue that architecture, as it is studied in Italy, is one of the most interesting ways to study culture. And so therefore, I think architecture, for me, is studying culture.
I have a question for both, actually. Professor Eisenman, you said a phrase that I have never heard, but I found really good, that facts are sacks that you have to fill with values. And as Rossi said, the buildings in the city are artifacts, physical facts that happen in the city, and as they happen, they embody values. And that's what I think that Professor Galiano was trying to present in his presentation. And I'd like to ask, how do you feel that the teaching of the value, the social value of the buildings, should be a part of architectural education?
Well, first of all, what I believe Mr. Rossi said was artifacts, not facts. And artifacts, as you say, already deal with values, and you could argue that what he meant, given what he produced, were iconic artifacts. And I think that what Rossi meant was that the city is made up of just building, but also icons. And certainly Aldo, whatever you want to say about his projects, their quality, was dealing with what would become icons. So that's number one. So I have no problem with Aldo and urban artifacts. The social value of architecture, how would I teach it? Since I'm not a sociologist, anthropologist, cultural historian, I leave that to others to teach. Because I can only teach something which I don't know much about, and that's architecture. And I certainly can't teach something where I don't know anything, which is sociology, anthropology, urban geography, etc. So don't ask me how to teach something I don't know anything about. You'd have to ask somebody who knew something about that.
As regards the question of values, I will say one thing. I'll quote my master, Alejandro de la Sota, who said that we architects are, on one hand, professional technicians who master a craft, and on the other, intellectuals who understand the society and the needs of society. But in no way artists, that very few of us would ever become, you know, touched by this very, very, I think, rare phenomenon of art, which I think affects very few people at any in any historical period. But of course, being an intellectual and being a good professional, I think that needs an ethical substance and an ethical grounding. And of course, I might disagree here with Peter. I think that the schools of architecture must also teach values and must also teach how our job is based on the conception of architecture as a profession of service to others.
Yeah, Okay, all the way back.
Yeah, let's do two more, one here and then one over on the side.
I have a question for Peter. To a certain point, I agree with God bless icons, and they dictate how they represent the culture. But are only icons enough to represent any culture? And what about rest of the spaces, as Professor says, and about teaching architecture? I think it's been reduced to learning a universal language which everybody can understand and you can build, basically, and trying to convince so many parties to build that thing. But building an icon can be afforded only by someone with a massive ego, like yourself, perhaps, and many other iconic architects. And what about rest of the people? And
well, I'll tell you something, because I'm glad you called me a massive ego, because you have a massive ego too, one, to stand up and say that, and two, to be here. You're at an iconic school, one of the iconic schools, they're gonna say the best school in the world. I don't know if you're from London or from this area so that it's your local school. I doubt very much if it's your local school, your local council school, which is a non-iconic school. You've chosen to come to an iconic school. What?
Absolutely.
So you and I are the same. You're just a young version of me. I think that you've chosen to come here because you believe you're going to be more effective in whatever community you're going back to in helping them to realize their dreams and aspirations, right? And architects are people who don't give the clients what they want. They give the clients what they want if they knew what they wanted. All right, if the clients knew what they wanted, they don't, right? And so therefore, that's why you're at an iconic place to understand what your role as an ego, and all architects who are here have got to have some version of ego, narcissism, etc., or they wouldn't even be here, right? And to convince your parents or whomever to spend how much money it costs to come here is certainly an incredible narcissism on your part. So I want to applaud you for standing up and joining me.
Okay, one more question. There was one over here, I think. Okay. Last question.
Thanks. I'm actually happy that that was the previous question because it's a perfect lead-in. Along those same lines, I think that it's clear we're all in support of icons, but at the same time, how many iconic architects are there in the world versus how many buildings are built? So how do we take those iconic lessons and apply them to grocery stores? Or should we apply them to grocery stores?
Look, here's the thing. First of all, what you all don't understand is I have had a running battle with Charles Jenks, and Charles will tell you this if he was here. I'm anti-iconic building, number one, all right? And I'm anti-Charles's portrayal of icons and the history of architecture, recent architecture, as icons. So, number one, I'm against icons. Number two, I'm doing a conference that Fernández-Galiano is going to participate in Madrid in February. It's called Architecture Against Design, right? To think of designing grocery stores is an absolute misuse of anything. Grocery stores don't need to be designed, right? I don't believe that people's living quarters need to be designed, right? I think iconic places like schools, churches, museums, public buildings, libraries, hospitals, prisons, all of those public processes need design. 90% of what is built, 99% of what is built, which are not public iconic functions, which are symbols of our culture, what our prisons look like, what our city halls look like, what our libraries look like, etc., are symbols of our culture. Grocery stores, no.
That's why I have always argued against the Seagram building being given a special dispensation on Park Avenue to set back like a church or like a public building, because it's the icon of a liquor company. And I think liquor companies are not necessarily needing icons, okay? So I've always been against the perpetration, as it were, or the seeping into society of branding for private industry, private corporations, and private concerns, whether they be grocery stores or liquor companies. We don't need design. And probably we have too many architects in the world with nothing to do but design grocery stores and garage renovations. No. Those things will take place by themselves and become fabric. And the minute you say we need to design fabric, then it's no longer fabric, it's something else. Fabric will take care of itself.
Thank you, Peter. And that'll be that draws the evening to a close. Thank you, Luis Fernandez-Galiano, for coming in, and Peter Eisenman for coming back. Thank you. And I think Peter's point might be well taken about liquor companies, but we just to remind everyone, it's a school with a bar in the center of the space upstairs. Please come upstairs. The conversation
without design
can go forward there.
You know what's wonderful about this school? I was here 50 years ago. The damn place is still the same. It's a great place. It's produced great students. It will continue to do so. And there's not an ounce of goddamn design in this place, all right? Yeah, so thank God for no design.
Thanks. Everyone, 10 o'clock tomorrow morning, the conversation will continue in some form. Peter's going to have a series of projects presented. Come downstairs into the lecture hall for that at 10 o'clock till about noon, and we can carry some of this forward. Thanks, everybody, for coming in. Thank you, guys. Within 20 minutes. Yeah, we're fine. A year or two ago.
See you.
You too. Oh, three. We're still Swiss. That's right. We're Swiss.
Okay.